Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and welcome to you on this third Sunday of Advent. This morning we have a little change. We thank Janet Stengel for playing the organ today. Vicki has had to be quarantined. So that's the world we're living in right now. Let us prepare to worship God. This is the day that the Lord has made, so let us rejoice and be glad in it. Come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. And breathe. Remember that you are a beloved child of God. So our Advent hope is for the restoration of the world. Yet we know that we have contributed to its brokenness. We also know that if we confess our sin, we can be restored to a right and a just relationship with God and with one another. So let us confess our sin. Let us pray. O God, you have called us to participate in your grace-filled work of rebuilding and repairing your creation. Yet we know we have fallen short of that calling. Indeed, we have contributed to the devastation of our world. We confess our sin, O God. Renew us, help us to be discerning and ready partners in your grace and love and hope. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God's mercy abounds. God's Advent grace goes before us, after us, through us, sometimes unbeknownst to us, restoring us, empowering us for participation in God's own work in the world. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven, and glory be to God. And may the peace of Christ be with you all. The Old Testament lesson for today is from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 61, verses 1 through 4, and verses 8 through 11. Listen now for God's word. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are a people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God. For he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. In the Gospel of our Lord according to John, from the first chapter, verses 6 through 8, and verses 19 through 28. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now, they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The stories of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Almighty God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. So, as different as the four Gospels are, they all include John the Baptist. The picture that we have from him comes mostly from Matthew and Mark, the Mark description we heard last Sunday. A wild-eyed prophet in camel's hair and leather with locusts and honey on his breath. The fourth gospel, the Gospel of John, offers no visual effects at all. In this account, we must deduce who he is just from what he says. Who are you? I'm not the Messiah. Are you Elijah? I am not. Are you the prophet? Nope. Who are you? I am the voice. Why are you baptizing if you are a nobody? There is somebody coming after me whom you do not know. The truth is, I don't know either. All I know is that I am not worthy to fiddle with his shoelaces. It must have been hard to be John. There he was, set apart by God to do one single thing with his life, to proclaim the coming one. And yet, he did not even have a name to shout out loud. He did not know who he was waiting for, nor when he would be coming. He didn't know whether to watch the sky or the earth. Maybe the one he was waiting for would come in some chariot of fire that no one could miss. But it was also possible that he would come incognito, so that only those who were searching for him would know that he had, in fact, arrived. The net effect of all of this unknowingness was that John didn't know who he was himself either. He knew what his job was, but there was no name for him. The priests and the Levites who had come from Jerusalem tried to put a label on him. They wanted to fit him into some sort of religious category that they knew something about so that they could get a fix on him. But he utterly escaped them. How could he not? The one who was coming would defy all categories himself. He would turn the known world upside down. So what could John be but a voice? A voice crying out in the wilderness, "Make straight the way of the Lord, the one you do not know, the one who is coming after me." So until that one came, John's life was just one long advent, awaiting in the dark for the light, awaiting without knowing for the one thing that would change everything. He couldn't name it, but he knew it was coming. And the knowledge alone was enough to make the wait worthwhile. On the whole, like we talked about last week, we are not very good at waiting. We prefer to reach out and grasp what we want right now. Either that or cross it off our lists. But the truth is that sometimes it's just not there to be grasped. Maybe it's not ripe yet, like a tomato that's still hard and green. Or maybe it's not even real yet, like a dream of the future that is still a long way off. Waiting, we have to admit that we're not in charge here. There are things we think that we cannot live without, that we are denied. And there are things we have given up wanting for ourselves that are suddenly dropped in our laps. We could say yes, and we can say no to these things, but we do not seem to be able to control them. Our lives are formed in the hands of a great mystery that does not ask us for our advice. So, if waiting is an aggravation, it is at least partly because we do not like being reminded of our limits. We like doing, like earning and buying and selling and building and planting and driving and baking. Making things happen. Whereas waiting is essentially a matter of being. Stopping. Sitting. Listening. Looking. Breathing. Wondering. Praying. It can feel pretty helpless to wait for someone or something that is not here yet, and that will or will not arrive in its own good time, which is not the same thing as our own good time. And yet, waiting is an essential part of the Christian life. Listen what we say when we break bread together. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. This is the mystery of our faith, that we are always waiting. Waiting for Christ to come to us, even though we believe that he has already come, and that he is coming to us right now. Is his coming past? Or is it present? Or is it future? It's all three. Our waiting is not nothing. It is something. A very big something. Because we tend to be shaped by whatever it is that we are waiting for. Have you noticed that? When you want something really badly, your whole life tends to rearrange itself around that goal. Think about it. What are you waiting for? And how is it shaping your life? Are you waiting for certainty, for healing, for love? Are you waiting for the vaccine? Are you waiting for recognition? Or retirement, for enough money to pay the bills? Or how about peace and justice on earth? Or an end to the pandemic? Or an end to the destruction of the planet? How about the dawning of a new age in which the wolf and the lamb shall feed together? Whatever it is that your hearts yearn for, chances are that it has something to do with your vision of what it would mean for you to be made whole, to be transformed into people who are not afraid anymore, whose basic needs are met, whose wounds are healed, and who are more nearly the people that God created you to be. It's the same vision that John the Baptist had of a great light that was coming into the world to outshine the darkness once and for all. We may be right about what will make us whole, or we may be wrong, but one big difference between us and John the Baptist is that he knew what he did not know. "Among you stands one whom you do not know," he told the priests and the Levites who came to him, who were looking for handles on the mystery. Read on in John's gospel and you will hear him say that exact thing two more times. "I myself did not know him." John waited without knowing what he was waiting for. He waited in the dark for the light without knowing what his name was or when he would be coming. He understood that everything else he was waiting for boiled down to waiting for God. And he was willing to forego the details, although that left him without any way to describe himself. "Who are you?" they asked him, but he could not say. "Are you the Messiah? No. Are you Elijah? No. Are you the prophet? No." All he could tell them about himself was that he was the voice. The voice sent to clear the way, to erase the board and wash it down, so that the unnamed, unknown, unimagined one who was coming after him would have some room to work. What are we waiting for? Let's tell the truth. We do not know, and still we are able to rejoice because the one who is coming is the one who has come and is coming to us now. We may be short on details, but we are not short on hope or wonder at this mystery whose good hands we are in. Whatever happens to us while we're waiting, however dark it gets before it gets light, this is what we believe. They are good hands. And may it be so. And thanks be to God. Amen. Today, as we go to God in prayer with our concerns and our joys, we can't help but remember the thousands of people who have lost their lives this week. Over 3,000 people a day now are dying from COVID. As you've heard all week, more than who died on 9/11. I'm angry about it. And I wonder why we aren't more outraged at this. Outraged at the fact that it didn't have to be this way. And I'm also aware of people who have died through execution because of the death penalty. The Supreme Court would not stay an execution. The pro-life Supreme Court would not stay an execution. Prayers for our country, for all of those who are suffering. And let us go to God in prayer. Let us pray. O God, you have called us to follow in the way of the one who was anointed to bring good news to the poor, release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, and to let the oppressed go free. Empower us, O God, to be faithful disciples of Jesus. In this season of Advent, help us to discern where you are already at work to renew and to repair. Help us to trust that your future, even now, is coming in our midst. Enable us, O God, to stand in solidarity with those who have been marginalized in our world. Help us to lift up and listen to voices long silenced. And as we give ear to their hopes and fears, help us to join together to rebuild and restore your world, a world that you envision for us in Christ. Indeed, during these tumultuous days of racial and political and social reckoning, help us to overcome paralyzing fear in our own lives, in our communities, in our world. Calm the fear in us, but animate the courage. Make us brave in confronting realities that deform and deface your world, so that we may participate in your work in our midst. Oh God, we pray also for the world of nations, especially for those places where violence is wreaking havoc. We pray for solidarity among us as we continue to grapple with a raging pandemic. We pray especially for healthcare workers around the world as they tend to the sick, for all who are desperately ill, and for their families. We pray for those in our own community who have lost jobs or revenue or healthcare, or loved ones during this relentless public health challenge. Help us to be agents of your love, care to those who are suffering. We pray especially for wise discernment by our nation's elected leadership, that they might work together constructively to find ways to aid those who are most afflicted. Hear our prayers, O God, for we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us when we pray to be bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold fast to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord your God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and remain with you always. Amen.